The Philippine peso continues its slump as it struggles to bounce back after hitting the 58th level to the US dollar. The Philippine Central Bank says it is ready to take action when the peso is under stress. But it asserts the BSP does not intervene in the foreign exchange market on a daily basis. Here with us today to discuss the peso's depreciation, as well as the performance of the bond market so far this year, we have Michael Ricafort of RCBC. So thank you, Mike, for joining us in the show.
Yeah, my pleasure, April. Nice to be back.
Regarding the peso, so the BSP, of course, is reassuring everyone that the peso's weakness is only temporary. And it's mainly triggered by the strong dollar. Right now, I think the past few days, the US dollar index has been weakening. So what do you think is the reason for the weak peso?
Well, April, for now, well, at least for the past 2 days, the peso already improved. It's already hovering at 58.50 levels already. It came from the other day, it reached a intraday high of 58.80. So that's the closest that it went compared to the record high of 59 that we saw in the latter part of September 2022 and up to October 17, 2022. So, yeah, but if you come to crunch the numbers, look at the metrics relative to the region, well, the peso is has already been aligned. Well, what am I talking about? About 1 to 2 months ago, the peso was relatively stronger compared to to most of the major ASEAN currencies. But
what would you attribute that relative strength of the peso compared to other ASEAN counterparts?
Well, there were seasonality factors, like during the around the Holy Week time, that was late March, maybe until early April. Well, of course, peso was relatively stronger back then. Also, the fact that the Philippine peso, well, at least as far as the local authorities are concerned, there's a good track record in managing the exchange rate, at least for the past 1.5 years, especially when prior to breaching above 57. That was prior to, well, the last time we saw that at below 56, rather below 57, was until early part of April. And we all know what happened last April. It was the unprecedented Israel and Iran conflict. So that was the time that the peso breached above 57 after being stable. If you notice, the whole of last year, the cap was at 56.99.
Mm-hmm.
That was the cap, even during the importation season. If you look at the charts, there's a clear defense there. Importation season was like August till September.
Mm-hmm.
That's a seasonal increase in importation. But towards the fourth quarter already, over November, December, there is already a seasonal appreciation of the peso.
Do you think that Governor Remolona was, of course, after the meeting, quoted as saying that, maybe starting in August we'll be cutting the BSP rates. So is that a factor, the potential, tightening of the spread between the peso and the US dollar?
Yeah, April, actually there's some correlation to that, April. True. Whenever we have seen some dovish signals and then suddenly there's this reaction by the exchange rate market. Though if you had to scrutinize further and run through and be more rational about it, whatever cuts there may be locally would only match what any Fed rate cut. So it would only neutralize, revert back to the spread of 100 basis points. For instance, the latest signals, earliest possible local policy rate cut would happen around August, third quarter. And that's based on the premise that if it already becomes imminent that the Fed would cut by September, and that has been the case already, maybe for lately, maybe at least for the past 2 to 3 days, it's already like 60% chance for a September cut. And because there's it's also factual that there won't be any BSP policy monetary policy meeting in September. So it follows that yeah, in anticipation of that, even if the BSP starts cutting by August policy meeting, it would only be, well, once the Fed starts cutting in September, say both by a quarter, that would be neutralized. It's just it would again maintain the interest differential of 100 basis points.
So in other words, in your opinion, at least, the BSP will not be cutting rates unless it is confident that the Fed will also be cutting rates in September. I'm just curious about your forecast for the peso by the year end. Do you think that, you know, will successfully stay below the 59 level?
Well, it's still possible, April, because we're kind of calibrated already with the rest of the region. The performance is the start of the year. Well, the peso is now like weaker by around 1 to 2%. Mm-hmm. Unlike just 2 months back, we're stronger by 1 to 2%. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of calibrated already as far as adjustments are concerned. And in terms of managing the... Of course, we all know that there's always a track record for... If there's a need to somehow manage it. Manage it, and there's some level of defense, and that we have experienced and witnessed it. And now, since for the past 2 years, since the Russia-Ukraine conflict, for more than 2 years already, the peso already depreciated by around 15%. So relative to our neighbors, we're weaker by around 1-2% also. Meaning, it goes to show that the peso already adjusted. Well, it already duly adjusted relative to our neighbors. So therefore, there's already some good reason for it to stabilize at these levels, at least to, at least where we are right now, at a little less than, well, at less than 59, at 50, we're now doing at 58 levels. So relative to our neighbors, so we're properly calibrated. And if you look at the external factors, the variables. Look at oil. Oil has gone down. Oil is already among the lowest in nearly 4 months, since early February. So, like NYMEX oil is doing at $75. More than a month ago, at the height of the Iran-Israel tensions, the peak was 87. So it's already lower by $12. And the oil is also among the lowest levels in 2.5 years since December of 2021. And the dollar is already going down. The dollar index versus the gauge of global currency is already the lowest in 2.5 months. So, and look at US Treasury yields. We have seen some improvement already. The 10-year Treasury yield, it's now doing at 4.30 levels.
Yeah.
It's already down in just a few days, in just a week. It's already down by 30 basis points. So that's also at least
some good news, I guess.
Yeah, it is. Maybe we have seen the worst.
Let's not talk about the bond market. I'm just curious if the you know, you talked about government bonds, and you said that, you know, we're seeing strong demand for the government bonds because we issued the $2 billion, and that was quite good, as you said, only 80 basis point spread. I'm just curious about your thoughts on corporate bonds. How is demand for corporate bonds, and, you know, are local companies actually issuing enough for the market?
Well, April, yeah, they're close to, well, it's the biggest conglomerates, the biggest corporates, whenever they issue bonds, their yields are, yeah, of course, there should be some premium or some spread over the sovereign or the government, Philippine government bond. But so far, the difference is not that huge anymore. Yeah, it's also a vote of confidence. The spread of, the corporate bond yields over the benchmark Philippine government bond yield. So it has narrowed also. If you look at the universe of bonds, both corporate and government, here in the Philippines as well as around the world, but of course, let's limit it to the safest ones, the safest. Well, because we need to recognize the fact, yeah, there's still this two wars, the geopolitical risk factors. So there's a tendency still from time to time to really be on the safe side, to be at the safest asset. So that includes also the safest sovereign bonds like US Treasuries and also the Philippine Treasury bonds, and also the safest corporates, especially from the biggest conglomerates and the biggest corporate for their bonds. And also, if you were, all yields now are at their cycle, meaning to say, at least for now, we have seen practically most of the bad news already priced in. When it comes to, well, the leading indicator still for the market, especially for the fixed income market, would be the trend of oil. If you are to really choose which is the most important leading indicator, it's really oil. Now, mm-hmm. oil is going down. That's the good news.
Do you think that, you know, it's a good idea for investors to, say, lock in those high yields by, say, buying bonds right now?
Oh, definitely, April. These are the cycle highs, among five-year highs. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, you know, the so-called yield to maturity, it came close to 7%. That was the peak in late April. Now it's doing like 6.5% to 6.7% mm-hmm. gross mm-hmm. of the 20% withholding yeah. tax. And, you know, that's relatively high from the point of view of investors.
Thank you very much, Mike, for your thoughts on bonds and, of course, on the peso, and hopefully, you know, we'll see better times ahead, because seasonally, as you said, you know, going to the second half of the year should be, you know, better for both bonds and the peso.
Yeah, thank you so much, April.
Okay. Yeah, thank
you
so
viewers.
Much, Mike.